Good morning, everybody. So glad to see you all here joining us for worship, those of you in person or online or over the radio. However you are being reached, we are glad to have you as we come together to worship our great God on this day. As you know, we do our announcements at the end, but because it is Father's Day, we're going to go ahead and do one announcement right off the bat. Happy Father's Day to all of you dads, grandfathers, or great-grandfathers. We're going to go ahead and have you stand up so we can recognize you for your love and work in raising your families. Let's go ahead and thank them. And rather than have you guys sit down, we're going to have everybody else stand up to welcome one another.
Our beginning in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We come before our Lord confessing our sins. Our help is in the name of the Lord who made heaven and earth. If you, O Lord, kept a record of sins, O Lord, who could stand? But with you there is forgiveness, therefore you are feared. Since we are gathered to hear God's word and call upon him in prayer and praise, let us first consider our unworthiness and confess before God and one another that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed, and that we cannot free ourselves from our sinful condition. Together as his people, let us take refuge in the infinite mercy of God, our Heavenly Father, seeking his grace for the sake of Christ and saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. Almighty God, have mercy upon us, forgive us our sins, and lead us to everlasting life. Almighty God, merciful Father, in holy baptism you declared us to be your children and gathered us into your one holy church, in which you daily and richly forgive us our sins and grant us new life through your Spirit. Be in our midst, enliven our faith, and graciously receive our prayer and praise through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. You may be seated.
Down in worship to sing the song of ages to the Lamb. And all who've gone before us, and all who will believe, sing the song of ages to the Lamb. Your name is the highest, your name is the greatest. Your name stands above them all thrones and dominions, all powers and positions. Your name stands above them all, and the angels cry, holy, all creation. Thank you. hear your people sing, holy to the King of Kings, holy you will always be, holy, holy forever, you will always be.
First reading this morning is from the Old Testament book of Job, the 14th chapter. This will also be the text for Pastor Jared's sermon this morning. For if there is hope for a tree, if it be cut down, that it will sprout again, and that its shoots will not cease. Though its root grow old in the earth and its stump die in the soil, yet at the scent of water it will bud and put out branches like a young plant. But a man dies and is laid low. Man breathes his last, and where is he? As waters fail from a lake and a river wastes away and dries up, so a man lies down and rises not again. Till the heavens are no more, he will not awake or be roused out of his sleep. Oh, that you would hide me in Sheol, that you would conceal me under your wrath be past, until your wrath be past. That you would appoint me a set time and remember me. If a man dies, shall he live again? All the days of my service I would wait till my renewal should come. You would call and I would answer you. You would long for the work of your hands. For then you would number my steps. You would not keep watch over my sin. My transgression would be sealed up in a bag, and you would cover over my iniquity. This is the word of the Lord. Our gospel reading is from the Gospel of St. Mark, the 4th chapter. Please stand with me for the reading of the gospel. Jesus said, "The kingdom of God is as if a man should scatter seed on the ground. He sleeps and rises night and day, and the seed sprouts and grows. He knows not how. The earth produces by itself, first the blade, then the ear, then the full grain in the ear. But when the grain is ripe, at once he puts in the sickle, because the harvest has come." And he said, "With what can we compare the kingdom of God, or what parable shall we use for it? It is like a grain of mustard seed, which, when sown on the ground, is the smallest of all the seeds on earth. Yet when it is sown, it grows up and becomes larger than all the garden plants and puts out large branches so that the birds of the air can make nests in its shade." With many such parables, he spoke the word to them as they were able to hear it. He did not speak to them without a parable, but privately to his own disciples, he explained everything. This is the gospel of the Lord. You may be seated.
At this time, we're going to invite up our Stephen ministers who are here for the commissioning. And while they are making their way down, for those of you who don't know, Peace Lutheran has a Stephen ministry, which is ultimately men and women from our congregation who have been given a heart to serve. They want to walk alongside you in life's challenges. Obviously, Pastor Dave and I would love to be able to do that for all of you. But it is great having this team of good people who know the love of Christ and want to share it with those who are in need. All right, ladies and gentlemen, we'll go ahead and have you guys stand facing me once again. And then, just to give you the warning, once again, we are going to have you turn around at the end and introduce yourself, so that way you're prepared. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, you have been equipped to serve as Stephen ministers at Peace. Listen now to these words from Scripture. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of compassion and the God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our troubles, so that we can comfort those in any trouble with the comfort we ourselves have received from God. Each of you has been comforted by God with the good news of Jesus' life, death, and resurrection for us all. We ask you now to join in serving our Lord and those in our congregation and community who need to be comforted. As Jesus has responded to your needs, we ask you to share the love of Christ with those in need and respond to the following questions with the words, yes, with the help of God. Are you prepared to meet those requests that we ask of you? If so, respond, yes, with the help of God. Are you prepared to nurture the skills you have learned and use them in service to others, to support, encourage, build up, and comfort people in their needs? If so, answer yes with the help of God. Are you prepared to serve as Stephen ministers at Peace Lutheran Church? If so, respond yes with the help of God. Now, congregation, I am addressing all of you. Now we ask you, fellow members of this family of God, to open your hearts to the ministry of these people and to pray for them, that they may be effective servants of Christ. Are you prepared to meet this request? If so, answer yes with the help of God. Will you accept their ministry when you need help and allow these individuals to work with you as you face struggles in your life, that you might receive support and help from your Christian brothers and sisters? If so, respond yes with the help of God. Yes. Brothers and sisters in Christ who are willing to take on the ministry of Christian caregiving, I commission you as Stephen ministers of Peace Lutheran Church in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us pray. O God, you have blessed these servants with gifts and talents and have provided them with an opportunity to help people in the name of Christ. May they serve you with the power of the Holy Spirit and bless all whom they serve. Grant them a special measure of your mercy and joy. Keep them strong in the faith you have given them for the sake of Christ, who cares for all of us in every way forever. Amen. Now, Stephen ministers, go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Amen. Now we're going to have you turn around, and we have, just so you all know, we have three new Stephen ministers, so I will give them the mic first, that they can introduce themselves. Go ahead and turn around, and there you go.
Hi, everybody. I'm Jason Moore.
Jason.
Cindy Cerna.
Cindy. Joni Marciniak.
Larry Ehlert.
Gene Plowman.
Kathy Case.
Tim Case.
I'll run it down.
Sarah Stair.
Dan Stair.
Darlene Jansen.
Lori Leiter.
Dennis Roachwhite.
All right, let's go ahead and give a big thank you to our Stephen ministers, both new and currently serving. Thank you, guys. You are free to head back to your seat. And at this time, we are going to invite our children up for a children's message. Hello. How are you today? Good? You like drawing cats and unicorns? That is awesome. I can't draw cats or unicorns. In fact, I don't think I can draw a whole lot of anything. Hello, friends. I am so excited to see you today. All right, I got a question for you. You ever done something maybe you shouldn't? Yeah. I know sometimes I do that, and it kind of weighs on me. You know, sometimes I took a cookie out of the cookie jar, and I probably shouldn't have. My wife's probably going to be pretty angry, and sometimes I tell fibs, and, you know, sometimes I get angry with people, and, they're falling off already. I don't know if I'm going to be able to get around, and, you know, sometimes I'm not the best that I could be. Do you think I'm going to have a hard time getting around with all this on? Yeah, it's going to keep bothering me. It kind of weighs down because I did stuff I shouldn't. And I don't know how I'm going to go on with my day, because all you guys are going to be looking at all these funny little sticky notes on me, right? Well, the good news is that we have something incredible. We can take all these things like my taking of the cookie out of the cookie jar and my getting angry when I shouldn't be angry, and we can take them all right here. See, I got them all gathered up, and I can put them away. Now, you might not have a fancy little folder, but you know what you do have that you can put all these in? You know what this is? That's a cross. What does that mean? It means God and Jesus. What did Jesus do for us again? He saved us from our sins. So before, when you guys got to see all the funny little sticky notes on me, you might have been thinking, wow, he made a lot of mistakes. Now, all you guys can see is this. Because you know what? Jesus loves us. It is a cross. Good job. Jesus loves us so much that he takes all of our yuckiness and all of our little post-it note moments, all of our mistakes, and he says, I'm going to take them, I'm going to put them right in here, and they're never going to come out again. So when people look at you, you know what they see? A child of God. Can you say that with me? I am a child of God. I am a child of God. You know what? Not only are you guys children of God, but all these people here, they're children of God too. So we're going to invite them to join us. Can you all say it with me too? I am a child of God. And that is great news, because it means all those things that make it hard to get around, they're gone. And instead, we get the cross, and we get Jesus, and we get his love. Can you pray with me? Fold your hands and repeat after me. Dear God, thank you for forgiving me and making me your loved child. All this we ask in your son's name. Amen. All right, friends, we have some treats over there in the church. Feel free to grab one as you head back to your seats. All sorts of good choices. Well, grace and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. You know, I like to think I'm a pretty analytical person. I try my best to think through my moves, think through where I want to go in life. I try and make sure I'm not making any mistakes. So one of the questions that I oftentimes ask is, what is this going to cost me? Maybe you ask yourself the same question. If it's a financial purchase, maybe you ask the question of, literally, what is this going to cost me? But even outside of that, I know I ask the question when it's something I want to do, someplace I want to go. I think, how much gas is this going to cost me? How much of my day is this going to cost? I think it's a question we ask often, even if we know it, because the fact of the matter is we're not super people. There's only so much we can get done. There's only so much time in a day. Everything has a cost, whether we recognize it or not. Do one thing, unable to do another. Well, I read a book a while back on this very idea of cost, things having a cost, and it was called The Invoice. And the invoice was about a man, an unnamed man, and he gets a bill one day. He gets an invoice in his mailbox, and to his surprise, it is monumental. There's no way he could possibly hope to ever pay the cost at the end of this invoice. Now, I should mention, too, this is a different universe than our own in this book, and the charges aren't for gas and electric, it's for joy. He's being charged for his blessings. So in this world, if you have a family that you love deeply and they love you, it's going to cost you money. If you got a promotion at work and you really love your job, it's going to cost you. If you took that glamorous vacation and now you feel relaxed and rejuvenated, it's going to cost you deeply. But see, what's surprising about this book is our main character, he hasn't had, at least from an outward perspective, that great of a life. In fact, it was pretty mundane. He lives in a small apartment, doesn't really do a whole lot, works for a dying movie store, so he's shocked. How could I have possibly accrued so much debt? And actually, at the end of the book, not to spoil it for you, we're left hanging as the reader, uncertain if this is a mistake or if he actually did rack up that much. And to be honest, I think he did. Because you see, his life might not have had very many super high highs, but it didn't have any lows. So he kind of forgot about the blessings he had each day. He forgot about the blessings that he got to enjoy each moment of his life that brought this debt up higher. And then the more I thought about it, the more I realized this book is a little bit closer to our lives than we might realize. Now, no, I'm not saying that you are going to be charged for the blessings of your life, but I am saying that there's a debt that rises. There is a cost. What if you went home today and there was an invoice in your mailbox? And instead of joys and blessings, it accounted all of your mistakes. What if it accounted your sins, your brokenness, and everything you wish you could forget? I can't speak for all of you, but I know that if I got that invoice in my mailbox, at the very bottom would be a debt I could not possibly hope to pay. It would make my stomach turn. And I know that would be it. See, that's the trick of living in a sinful world. It's the trick of being in a sinful world and unfortunately being sinful individuals. As we get lulled into this false sense of security. Because we spend so much time in our lives focused on all of this, our relationships with one another. And don't get me wrong, that's great. We should. But we forget to remember about our relationship this way, with God in heaven and what He sees as righteous and what He knows we do in our sinfulness and in our brokenness and the debt that we accrue to Him. You see, the trick is when we live in a sinful world, we start to forget that we are sinful. We confess it on a Sunday. We sin in thought, word, and deed. All of a sudden, all these sins pour out that we can't even possibly comprehend. And those are the ones that we forget. Maybe they're not sinful at all. At least I'm not as bad as somebody else. And then there's the ones that they're so close to our heart that we become defensive when somebody points them out. Because again, how dare they? I am a righteous person. I live my life for others. I think I have it figured out. See, just like our character in that book, we get so focused on our good standing with one another that all of a sudden we build up this platform of false confidence. I am righteous. I am good. I have lived a good life. I can stand on my own two feet. There can't possibly be a debt in my mailbox, but I promise you, for me and for you, there is. There is a cost for our sins, and unfortunately, the cost is death. That's what we're going to look at today in our reading from Job. So to set the context for today, there's really not a whole lot of context. The book of Job is pretty self-contained. We don't know exactly when it takes place. We don't know where, but we do know a couple things. We know it's about a guy named Job. He's successful. He's got a family. And in fact, at the very beginning, it says he's a righteous man before God. He's living a pretty good life. But to our surprise as the reader, right off the bat, Satan, of all people, makes entrance. And Satan walks in and he starts talking to God. And he says, hey, God, you know that person, that Job character that you love so much and who loves you? He says, that person doesn't love you for you. You've given him such a good life. If you took it away, he would hate you too. And Satan starts working this chaos, and he starts trying to break everything apart. And finally, God says, you know what? Okay. Do what you're going to do, but don't kill him, because you will see that Job is a righteous man. So he does. And to our surprise, Job's life gets turned upside down. Once successful, family, healthy, everything else, gone. Success, livestock, disappeared. Health, waning. And maybe most heartbreaking of all, entire family, gone, dead, taken away. I can't help but feel like Job was probably sitting there in this moment when everything else had been taken and simply waiting for the release of death, that final consequence of sin, because there's no possible way his life could be any worse. There's no coming back from this. And then we get the entrance of a couple other people. Job's friends show up. And to their credit, they try to do well at first, but they also make mistakes. See, Job's friends show up and they try to comfort him at first, but then the questions start to come. Two questions arise for Job and his friends. First off, his friends start to ask, Job, why is this happening to you? Clearly, you're a bad person. God wouldn't have done this to you if you weren't an awful individual. You know what? In fact, I bet you deserve even worse for all the sins you committed. And the second question they end up contemplating is this. Why? Why do bad things happen to good people? Job, you seemed like a righteous individual. Why is it that God is punishing you so severely? And maybe you know that question personally. Have you ever asked, God, why are you doing this to me? Why do bad things happen to good people? Why do you allow this? I lived my life for others. I lived my life for you. I was a righteous individual. I deserved better. Why me? And if that's the question that you're asking, just as Job's friends are asking, I'm telling you now, there's a mistake in the question itself. You see, Job, his friends, even us today, we get so stuck focusing on our relationship with one another. We get so stuck focusing on our own righteousness, our own goodness. I am a good person. I deserve better. And if you start right there, you already are going to have it wrong. We need to start somewhere else. And if this is getting into the weeds, maybe I'll make it a little more tangible for you this morning. Have any of you ever been pulled over for going 2 or 3 miles over the speed limit? I did have a couple people raise their hand when I asked that question at the last service, so I'll admit it, I have. In high school, I got pulled over going 2 or 3 miles over the speed limit. And you know what? I was irate. I was seething. I was so angry. Can you imagine the injustice? I'm driving around, there are people going 10 miles over the speed limit, 15 miles over the speed limit, and I'm doing my measly 2 or 3. I mean, 5 over is a given. You're allowed that, I thought. And now this police officer, he must have had it out for me. I don't know what I did, but he pulled me over. So I went home with this anger, this frustration, and I wanted to lament. I wanted nothing more than to go home and share all of my frustration. And I walked in the door ready to just unload. And I said, Mom and Dad, can you believe this? I got pulled over for going 2 or 3 miles over the speed limit and he didn't have any right. And all of a sudden they stopped me. My dad said, but were you speeding? And I said, yeah, but you're not listening to me. It was only 2 or 3. And he said, no. Were you speeding? And I said, Dad, just listen to me, 2 or 3. And he said, no, son, were you speeding? There it is, laid low, nothing left to say. Yes, I was speeding. Yes, I broke the law. Yes, I was unrighteous in this moment, and I did not have a leg to stand on. Didn't matter if it was 2 or 3 or 100 miles over the speed limit, I had broken the law, and I was convicted. And the fact of the matter is, this is what it comes down to for all of us. We live in a sinful world, and unfortunately, we are sinful. Dear friends, if we always try and stand right here, if we always try and stand right here on our own 2 feet, on our righteousness, if we always stand in life praying up to God and saying, "Why me? I am righteous, I am good, I have it figured out," then I promise you, you will always be confused and you will always be angry. Instead, I invite you to join me and join Job on this side. And just confess and understand, yes, I am sinful, and yes, I am broken, and yes, I make my mistakes, and yes, I should be convicted under the law, because when you stand here, you are ready to receive the love and the grace and the gospel of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. You are ready to receive all of Him, because the fact of the matter is that no matter how broken you feel, it is not your brokenness that defines you. It is Christ that defines you and me. Job says this for us in our reading for today about his standing with God. He says, "For then you would number my steps. You would not keep watch over my sin." Now, in order for that to make sense, maybe we need to take the context of that whole reading for today. Basically, what Job is saying at the beginning, he says, you know what? If a tree dies, it gets to sprout up again. If a river flows dry, that water might return. But what happens when a man dies? Breath will not be drawn. There's no possible hope for him. Job is lamenting. He's saying, please pass over me. Is there a place I can go where your judgment will not reach me so that I might have a moment when you will not watch over my sins or count my steps, that I will be redeemed? And later in the book, God says that Job spoke rightly about him. So what does that mean? It means that Job is sinful. It means that we do have our sin, that we are sinful. But it also means that God has a plan, that there will be a day when sins will be counted no more, that steps will not be counted, that it will not be counted against us because we will be made righteous and redeemed children of God. What is so incredible about this is it means that God doesn't sit there and hold on to each of our sins and ponder them day after day after day. No, instead, because of what He has done, they are forgiven and they are forgotten. Because Christ has paid them all. That invoice, that monumental debt, paid in full. Job says this at the end of our reading. He says, "My transgression would be sealed up in a bag, and you would cover over my iniquity." Dear friends, your sins are covered up. They are buried, never to be seen again. That is our great news for today. It's what gave Job strength amidst everything he faced, and I hope it is what gives you strength today. That monumental list is paid for. It is overcome. A sacrifice has been paid on your behalf and mine, and it is the sacrifice of God's very own Son. Jesus Himself came down into this earth. He walked in flesh. He took all of our condemnation, all of our sins, and He walked the path of judgment where we deserved. He lived and He died for us. But most importantly, He rose again for us, for you and for me. That means all of our sins died there upon that cross with Him, but where He rose, they stayed. His blood sealed them away, never to be seen again. And that very same blood that seals away all that brokenness is the very same blood that seals away in your heart your place as a child of God, a redeemed, loved creation of our King. Job says this also, and I want you to hear it. Listen very closely. He says, you would call and I would answer you. How you would long for the work of your hands. This is Job talking to and about God. I want to read it again. He says, you, God, would call and I would answer you. How you would long for the work of your hands. There is simple yet profound beauty in those words. Job is the work of God's hands. You and I are the work of God's hands. And that means no matter how broken you feel today, no matter what it is that you brought into this church today, no matter what was weighing down upon your shoulders today, you are wanted. You are washed clean of all that brokenness, all the sins, anything that weighs you down, and you are set free and you are yearned after by our God who has stopped at nothing to call you his own because you are his wonderful work. You were beautifully and wonderfully made, given a life, given a path before you drew a single breath. All of this was done for you before you were a single atom, before you were anything, before your great, 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 great grandparents were alive. You were yearned for. You were redeemed. You were saved and you were wanted. Sin has no more power in your life. Death does not get the final say for you. Dear friends, when God calls you, he does not call you into the grave. He calls you into his open arms, in his kingdom for all time. I want to draw your attention to one last book for today. This one's a little different than the first one. So this book is by an author called C.S. Lewis, and if you haven't read him, I'd highly recommend it. He's a Christian author, and he does some great stuff. But one of my favorite books by him is called Screwtape Letters. Now, I need you to bear with me because it is a different kind of book. See, Screwtape Letters is a book following two demons of all things. And they're talking to each other. And the book follows their dialogue with one another as they sort of plot. They're plotting how to overthrow a Christian. How can we pull him away from God? How can we get him to denounce his faith? How can we get into his heart and start sowing corruption? And within this book, one of the chapters is all about the highs and lows of the Christian life. The moments when we feel on top of the world or like God cannot possibly reach us. And I want to read for you a quote from this book. I'll summarize it as best I can after I read it, but here's what he has to say. Says, our cause is never more in danger than when a human, no longer desiring but still intending to do our enemy's will, looks around upon a universe from which every trace of him seems to have vanished and asks why he has been forsaken and still obeys. Now, if that didn't make any sense, I'll say it another way. No stronger outward sign of faith could a Christian have than when they wake up and they feel like the odds are insurmountable. Like the darkness is simply creeping in and there is no possible hope. God is gone. But also, know full well that that is not true, that God is always there, that he is victorious over death, sin, and the devil, and that as his beloved children, we do not walk alone in this world because he has a plan, and that plan sees us home in his kingdom for all time. God is active, he is victorious, and he is with you, his beloved, yearned after creation. Dear friends, through the sacrifice of Christ, you have been claimed. Through the Holy Spirit, you have been given faith. That means no matter what brokenness you face out in this world today or even within yourself, it is not too much for our loving and caring God. He is greater than all of our giants, and he has defeated them on our behalf through the power of the cross. So this week, whatever the trial is you face, whatever weighs down upon your shoulders, whatever sins nag you, know that there is a cost, but that it has been paid by our loving Lord and Savior Jesus. There is comfort in our faith. There is a unique power in following our Lord. And when times are tough, I'd encourage you to remember that God walks alongside you, wanting nothing more than to have a relationship with you, his beloved child. Let us pray. Dear God, we give you thanks for this day and for its blessings. None so great as the sacrifice of your Son. We give you thanks that you have claimed us, redeemed us, forgive us daily, and welcomed us into your family so that one day we might sing your hosannas in your kingdom for all time. All this we ask in your Son's name. Amen. At this time, I invite you to rise and join me as we confess our common faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, a being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried. He descended.
You may be seated. At this time, we'll receive the offerings. Gracious Father of all, we thank you for your love and care for us. In praise and worship and thanksgiving to you, we return a portion of what you have first given us as tithes, gifts, and offerings to your altar, and we pray that you would bless them as they are used by Peace Lutheran Ministries to share your gospel message with the world in need. These things we ask in Jesus' name, amen.
Hosanna, Hosanna in the high.
Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna in the highest.
We have one addition for the prayers already found in your worship folder. We will be praying for the family of Grant Hannes, son of Dan and Peggy Hannes, and husband to Molly Frisch Hannes, the daughter of Jim and Becky Frisch. Grant passed away unexpectedly at home in Madison on Monday after suffering a ruptured aneurysm. Let us pray for the whole Church of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Lord God, your Holy Spirit plants your word and causes it to sprout and grow as it pleases you. Bless the preaching and teaching of your word and send faithful laborers into your fields to share your gospel message of love, both here and abroad. We especially pray that you would prepare and send teachers to fill the open positions at Peace Lutheran Schools for the coming school year. Father, we are bold to ask for all things because you have given us your Spirit as a guarantee. Hear us as we intercede in Jesus' name for those in every need, especially members Nancy Hunter, Stephanie Wolf, Dan and Gloria Cohn, Tom and Angie Beneshek, Della Boers, Tim Case, and Lila Posler, friends and family Jan Young, Kathy Thorpe, and Vic Novak, for those injured in military service, and those known to each of us. Grant healing and restoration to each according to your good and gracious will. Father of all, we thank and praise you for all our Peace Lutheran Ministry family of believers and name before you today Ashley, Nate, Conway and Aspen Schmidt, Megan Schmidt, Jim and Mary Schofield, Aaron Schofield, Austin Schreiber, and Cassandra, Cody, Ellie, Silas, and Bentley Schroeder. Guide us and bless us in our lives and lead us to grow in our faith. Merciful Father, bless and watch over those serving in our nation's armed forces. May they serve diligently and bravely, and may you grant them your care and keeping when their duty takes them into danger. Gracious Lord, we thank you for all the Stephen Ministry leaders and ministers in our midst as they serve you and your people. Bless each of them and bless all those they care for. O God, give courage and comfort to the families and friends of Deanna Cox, Pastor Don Sprangler, and Grant Hannes in their time of grief as they mourn the loss of their loved ones. Assure them of your promise of eternal life in heaven with you for all who believe in Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. Heavenly Father, from whom all fatherhood is named, we give you thanks for earthly fathers. Give them confidence in their station and zeal for their task to care for their families faithfully. Make them examples to their children of godly life and love of your word. Bless their work of bringing up children in the fear and instruction of the Lord, and give them the comfort of your absolution over all their shortcomings. Gather us together with all our fathers to your eternal household, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please stand with me as we pray the prayer Lord taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Gracious Lord, as we leave this place, keep us mindful of all the price you have paid for us. And Father, we pray that the joy of our faith would be evident to those around us in our everyday lives. These things we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Before we conclude our service, we do have just a couple of announcements. First off, I would encourage you, as you go out, you'll see on our bulletin board one big orange panel with a map on it. I'm going to continue to put kind of the worm in your ear. That is our discipleship map. So if you had sort of a meaningful moment with somebody, you prayed with them, you had a conversation you hope to carry on, go ahead and stick a pin in that map. And the hope is we're going to see the church active. We're going to see not only one individual, but God's body, or Christ's body, out in Antigo, sharing the gospel, sharing the good news, and hearts being reached. Also, we are starting a new Bible study series between services, and we're going through season 2 of The Chosen. We went through the first half of the first episode, so come by next week to get us for the second half and continue on for the summer. Also, just to have it on your calendar, former Vicar Bryce, now Pastor-elect Bryce, is going to be ordained on July 13th at Hope Lutheran at 2 o'clock, and then his installation is going to be on July 20th at Emmanuel in Wisconsin Rapids at 2 o'clock. So get those down on your calendar. I know he has a lot of love for this congregation, and I'm sure that you here have a lot of love for him. So this is a great way to support him as he begins his ministry down there. With that, blessings to you, and I guess we'll go ahead and receive the Lord's blessing.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and give you his peace. Amen.
Standing on this mountaintop, looking just how far we've come, knowing that for every step you were with us. Healing on this battleground, seeing just how much you've done, knowing every victory was your power in us. Scars and struggles on the way, but with joy our hearts can say, our hearts can say. Never once did we ever walk alone. Never once did you leave us on our own. You are faithful, God, you are faithful. You are faithful, God, you are faithful. Your praise.